All right, awesome. So I think we are going to get started as more people join us. So as I was just saying, if you could say either via phone or in the chat box, your name, your role within your community, and where you're located, that would be really great. And then the kind of icebreaker question to get to know everyone a little bit better is about what social media platform you use the most frequently, like yourself as an individual. So I see that some people still haven't introduced yourself. So feel free to do that using your phone line or in the chat box here, either way, whatever is easiest for you all. And as you guys are doing that, I will introduce myself and our content expert guest today. And so my name is Hannah Raich, and I work in the Member Services Department at Youth M.O.V.E. National. And so I speak with a lot of our chapter membership and also those who are hoping to become members of the Youth M.O.V.E. National Network. And my most frequently used social media site is probably Facebook, but Instagram is definitely a close second for me. And we have Michael Collado with us today, and he is our social media kind of guy, our go-to guy, and I'll have him introduce himself a little bit more.
Sure. So my name is Michael Collado. I'm the communications coordinator at Youth M.O.V.E. National, and if I had to choose the social media network I use the most, it's definitely Twitter. I'll probably be on there during this webinar somehow. That is what I use the most.
All right, awesome. So I see a lot of new names joining us today, which is really great. Welcome, and thank you for continuing to type in our chat box here and introduce yourself. So I think that we only have one participant that's joined by phone today, but if you do decide that you want to join by phone so that you can kind of participate with the question and answer part instead of by chat but by phone, just make sure that your line stays muted if you're not talking so we don't have any background noise while we are listening to Michael talk to us about branding and social marketing today. Continue to use the chat box feature as much or as little as you'd like to. I'm going to hand it over to Michael to get us started.
All right, then. Okay, so let's get started. I'm going to have to use all of my limbs. Okay, so really quickly, what is this presentation? And then who am I and why should you be listening to me? Those are really good questions. So today's presentation is called What to Say, How to Say It, and Who to Say It To. It's an elongated presentation I did in Ohio, if you went to the Youth M.O.V.E. National Fred Luck Conference in Columbus, Ohio. And it's also a riff of another presentation I'll be doing at the Federation Conference in Phoenix next month, if you're going to that. Today we'll be discussing communications and branding throughout the next hour or hour and a half or so. So that's what the presentation is. So why should you listen to me? Hello, everyone. My name is Michael Collado. Like I said, I'm the communications coordinator at Youth M.O.V.E. National. I'm also a social marketing technical assistance provider with the Caring for Every Child Mental Health Campaign, which, yes, is a mouthful. I first got my start in system of care work as an intern at Youth M.O.V.E. Miami about 2.5 years ago, I would say. After that, I was staffed at Youth M.O.V.E. Miami and Federation of Families, Miami-Dade chapter, as a digital media specialist. So what that meant was producing video, facilitating workshops for youth on how to use multimedia, creating flyers and brochures, updating websites, running social media campaigns, doing newsletters. If it was digital communications, I did it. So that's the presentation. And that's who I am. Full disclosure, I come from a very large family, not a large media family, but a very otherwise large family. So I speak really, really, really quickly, and it has been a problem for me my entire life. So feel free to type in the chat box that I need to throw it down or repeat something. Shelby, will the PowerPoint be emailed? We'll actually have it available to download toward the end of the webinar. So what's the point of today's presentation? I hope you'll come out of today understanding that branding is way more than just design, there are so many other factors. I hope you'll gain some semblance of what communication is and how to craft different parts of a communication plan. And then finally, I hope you understand how branding and communication are inextricably linked. There's a strong tie there. What you're communicating and how you're communicating it, even if you don't intend it to, is speaking to what your brand is, because people remember you by how you communicate. So let's get to it. I'm going to try an experiment. Type literally anything in the chat box if you can identify at least one of these logos. It can be anything. It can be like a string of letters. I don't care. I mean, preferably the name of the company, but you can literally type AZB, whatever the case is. Chocolate, yes. You can type chocolate if you want. I'm not picky. Okay, I think people are typing, so I'm going to go with the fact that people do recognize the logos. When I do this in person, everyone's hands go straight up, right? Now keep typing in the chat box, by the way, if you can identify at least one logo, what the true colors of that logo is, not just black and white. Money talks. I don't get outside. I need you to get outside, Eric. Okay, it seems like you guys really do know. So people really identify with logos, right? It's something that's really ingrained into our memories, our society, our sense of self sometimes. You can probably even see only a part of a logo and identify which company it comes from with some fair accuracy. And I think that's the reason why whenever there's a youth or family organization, or frankly, any organization that wants to brand itself, they're like, we got it. Step one to branding ourselves, we need a logo. It's not even like point A to point B. It's like point A to subsection one. It needs to happen like right this second. And when you're developing a logo, what else comes with that? Usually it's colors and design, and it's fonts. Fonts galore. Like, we need to choose the fonts right this second. It's like, we need to know what our fonts are right now. And that's how it happens. Usually when family and youth organizations are thinking of branding themselves, they're like, we've got it. We need to get a logo. We need to know what our fonts are going to be. And we need to choose our colors. And that product is always going to be teal. And that resource is always going to be yellow. And the rest of the things we publish will only ever be purple. And there you go. We did it. We branded. That's it. Except, not to rain on the parade, but you're not really done branding once you figured out your logo and your design. Because the way you look, and by you, I mean your organization or your program, which they'll be using a lot throughout this entire presentation, it's really only half of your brand. It's not really the be-all and end-all of what your brand is. People aren't going to remember you by the fonts you choose or the colors you decided to go with if they have nothing else to connect that to. So what is that something else? What are we missing if we're only tackling half of that brand? It's your voice. It's your personality. It's the way in which you communicate to your audiences and the world. I mean, look at it this way. Take the time right now to think of your best friend or your mom or your boss or your significant other or whomever, someone you have a relationship with. Is the first thing you think of, or the majority of things you think of, the clothes they wear or their hairstyle or what have you, any other physical attributes? Chances are the first thing you think of are the things that can describe who they are. Are they funny? Are they serious? Are they pragmatic? Are they frenetic? Or whatever.
Can you hear me? I cannot type on the message box. I cannot type. I don't know how to do it on my phone. But my name is Julian, and I'm from Youth Move New Mexico.
Thank you for joining us, Julian. I've never used Adobe Connect by phone, so I'm not sure the text box.
Okay.
But if you have any questions, feel free to just chat with us by phone.
All right.
Thank you.
Yeah, so the things that people remember people by usually aren't their physical attributes. It's usually the things that they can describe their personality, whether they're funny, whether they're serious. That kind of personality link is true for relationships we develop. And honestly, it's true for your brand as well. So think about it. What is your voice or your personality? In other words, what do you talk like? Is it happy? Is it fun? Is it sad? I would hope not, because that would be a really weird voice to have, sad, but you do you, if that's what you want to do. Thinking about what kind of voice you want to project is important, because I guarantee it'll help it'll be the number one thing people associate with your brand. And that's going to help people remember you. So that's truly key. So now that you figured that out, or you know that, how and when do you use your voice? Whenever you're doing any sort of communication. So what is communication? We could spend 4 years, thousands of dollars, and countless hours in classrooms going over models of communication and modes of communication, when really, communication is just when you say stuff to people. Like, I'm not trying to dumb that down. That literally just is what communication is. And guess what? You're already doing it. Have you ever literally spoken to a person as a representative of your organization, or have you ever passed out a flyer? Congratulations, you're doing communication, right? We do communication through a variety of methods. When we speak in person with people, for example, has anyone ever tried to explain system of care to anyone not involved in system of care? Because I once tried to explain it to my mom, who still doesn't understand it. And it took 45 minutes and like three diagrams, and she was still lost. It's fine. It took me 2 years. But what I mean to say is that whenever you pitch your program, or whenever you develop a brochure, or whenever you update your website, or post on social media, or consult with youth and families, that's communication. Where you're kind of lost. That's communication. I also want to point out that when you send meeting reminders, or you send reports to maybe executives or what have you, that's a mode of communication as well. And chances are you're thinking of that already. Like, you're like, how do I brag in this report, even though it's all just factual information? That's thinking of things through a communications mind. So to put this better in perspective, it's like, yes, you're doing it, but what are the different parts and variables so you can be strategic about it? Because that's always key. So when I was in school, a professor of mine drew out a very great model of communication, and I decided to recreate that model for you today. I am an artist, and I decided to lend my craft into drawing out this model of communication for you. Here it is. And I'm so glad we're doing this over the internet, because usually in person, people are like, oh, so beautiful. How did you get so talented? And I'm like, stop, settle down. We don't have time. So I know what you're thinking. This is like an original Picasso, but what does it mean? Let me help. So really, here we have demonstrated the three important areas of communication. So on the left, you have your messages, or your message. And that's what you say, that sort of cone going to the second stick figure. That's your channel, or how you say it. And on the right, you have your audience, or in other words, who you say it to. So the squiggly lines happening there, I'll briefly go over in a second, but I don't want you to think too hard about it. That's what we call noise. So that's a communication model. If anyone has any questions so far, please feel free to interrupt me through the phone or through the chat box.
Michael, I actually have a question for you. This is Hannah.
Go for it.
I mean, I know you know it's me, but anyhow. So my question is, do you have an example of like a brand that has a really like obvious language or like communication style that you can point to kind of like give us a reference point?
So one of the things that I was thinking about was Starbucks for some reason, because I have a friend who loves Starbucks, and every time someone asks him, why do you love Starbucks, his answer is really that it's the same everywhere he goes. The taste is the same, but also the atmosphere is the same. That's different than what your mind, sorry, I'm reading the chat box. That's different than typing out communication or sending out a report, but it's still part of what you're communicating, whether it's your brand or the way those restaurants look, or the menus in those restaurants. There's a certain atmosphere. It's a consistency that's the same from Miami, and I just went to Seattle, the original place for Starbucks. It's the same in Seattle as it is in Miami. It does not change from one part of the country to the next. Really, when you think about a great mode of communication, what you're thinking about is people who, or organizations who streamline what it is they're saying, how it is they're going about saying that. And key is that consistency. Another one, I don't mean to say in like a fast food kind of world, but another one that I think about all the time is Taco Bell. Because I think if you're on social media and you don't follow Taco Bell, I don't follow Taco Bell either, but I do enjoy when I see a Taco Bell post. The consistency is like through the roof. The messaging from like the bags they use at their restaurants to the tweets they send out, to their Facebook posts, to their commercials on TV, it is all the same. There's no way you can get that mixed up. I hope that answered the question a little bit.
Yeah, that was helpful. I just wanted to have like a better idea of what, like, not necessarily communication with words or whatever, but like just, yeah, the consistency part did clear it up. And I think Starbucks is a really good example of consistency.
Yeah. It's the same anywhere you go. So that's great, the model of communication. And we're going to get into the model of communication way more in depth in just a few seconds, well, a few minutes. But you're probably at this point like, okay, so how do I figure out what my messages are? You guys, you want the secret. You want the answer. I've got the secret. I've got the answer. It's going to blow your mind. Trust me. The way you determine what to say and your message, in other words, is to determine your audience. I promise this is like the secret to all secrets. So remember when you were in high school, or maybe some of you are still in high school, and your English teacher was always like, yeah, but who's the audience? It turns out they were right. As much as we didn't want that to be the case, they were absolutely right. My 11th grade teacher, English teacher, used to take our essays and take a red Sharpie, and she would write across the page diagonally, so what? ? Which scarred us, but she was right. I mean, I like to bring this up, even though it's a little convoluted, but my favorite genre to read and write is creative nonfiction. If you're wondering what creative nonfiction is, it's true stories well told. So if you've ever read someone's personal essay, or maybe you've read someone's personal story on how they dealt with a mental health or substance abuse or misuse situation, or they have a lived experience story, if you've ever read one of those, you've probably read creative nonfiction. We ask ourselves all the time, what's the difference between someone's personal story and an essay, or rather, someone's personal story like an essay, and a diary? And the answer is, a diary doesn't have an audience. Figuring out who your audience is, or who your audiences are, that's going to help you with the rest of your communication. It's just so very key to everything. It's like working backward almost, but I promise you, once you figure that piece out, everything else just falls perfectly into place. So then the question is, who do you determine who your audiences are? You really, really want to map this out. You want to start by figuring out who your key stakeholders are, both internal and external. Is it youth members, family members, the general public, executives, host organizations? Who needs to know stuff, essentially? And then you're probably going to find out that you have more than you thought you did, because as an organization, and especially as one in a system of care, you have to communicate a lot of things to a lot of different people. And then you want to figure out what they would be interested in. So I want to take a quick detour because this is really random, but please stay with me here. Does anybody watch Silicon Valley? It's okay if you don't. And feel free to type or not type in the chat box. Otherwise known as that show on after Game of Thrones. So if you don't watch Silicon Valley, it's a show about a group of guys, pictured here, and they're trying to come up with, they did come up with an application, and based off that application, they're trying to launch a startup, a new organization. The application is called Pied Piper, and what it does is it compresses files like to a ridiculous amount so that you could have like 5,000 Blu-ray movies on your phone or something. I don't know if that's the actual case, but that's what they make it seem to be. I don't understand the technologicalness of it all, and you don't have to either. I don't think the writers of the show do either, but that's not what this story is about. What it is about, and if you don't watch the show, spoiler alert, and I apologize. what it is about is that they finally, after like three seasons, they're finally getting ready to send out their application into the world and become an actual organization, right? But before they do that, what they need to do is test their application. So the way they test their application is that each one of them sends a link of the app to test to their friends. And their friends come back to them and they say, wow, the app is really great. It works so well. Like, this is awesome. This is going to be the next big hit. It's going to be great. So they're like, that's fantastic. We're going to launch the app. They launched the app. Everyone's loved it that they've sent it to thus far. They launched the app, and the app is actually a huge failure. It's a gigantic flop. And they're like, what just happened? Everyone told us it was great. Why is this flopping right now out of nowhere? So they go out into the communities of people, general people, who want to test it. And what they find is that when they ask people why they aren't using the app, people tell them, it's too convoluted. I don't understand what this application is about. And the reason that happened was because they sent out the testing of the app to their friends, who are people who understand technology and understand what the app was actually doing. They made an application that was too convoluted and too complex for the average person to understand or use. So what I mean to say is, even though all that feedback was popular before they launched Pied Piper, they weren't really cognizant of who their audience was. Their audience wasn't just tech people in Silicon Valley to use this application. Their audience was general people like you or me. So people didn't understand how to use it because they didn't test it with the right people. They weren't thinking of their audience, not at all. And that's so very critical, because your audience determines everything you do in communication. It determines your messages. It determines your channel. It determines everything you do. So I don't want to stress, I do want to stress, actually, because I can't stress it enough. Your audience is key to figuring out everything about your communications plan. I promise you, it is everything. So once you've figured out who your audience is, you want to identify or you want to question a little bit more about them by asking three questions. And the first is, what do they need to know? You want to pinpoint, what is it that, what kind of information do they need to be cognizant of? Because not everyone needs to know everything. You might want to communicate meeting reminders with youth, but you don't really need to communicate that with executives, probably. Or you might want to talk about budgets and executives with executives, but that might not be something family members need to know. I mean, it might be something youth need to know, because you might want to be that transparent, but you may not. It's really up to you and what you think those audiences need to know. That's going to help you with your messages, Pete. The second question, it's a great question, Hannah. So what are some of Youth M.O.V.E. National's audiences, and how does it affect the branding strategy of our organization? So some of Youth M.O.V.E. National's audiences are actually things that are probably true for your organization. So it's youth leaders within our chapter network. It's Youth M.O.V.E. members. It's partners within systems of care at an executive level. It's sometimes us. So sometimes Youth M.O.V.E. National's audience is actually just me and Hannah within the organization. It's a lot of people. Sometimes it's just the general public. And when you're trying to dissect that, right, like what do they need to know? Well, executives might need to know sort of that professional piece, but what they also might need to know is good news about our organization, so that they know that the organization is doing well and that we're making an impact. Youth leaders, for example, you may need to know that this webinar was happening today, and that was something that we needed to communicate with you, and that was part of our communication plan. And that went out through the weekly emails that Hannah sends out and all that great stuff. How does that impact our branding strategy for Youth M.O.V.E. National? Really, that's a piece that I'm going to get to a little bit later, but the way it impacts it is that we filter everything, or at least we're trying to get to that phase, where we're filtering everything that people need to know through what our voice and what our personality is. It's something we have to do a bit of introspection of, but truly that's how it impacts our branding. The second way it impacts our branding is that we're cognizant of the fact that we want to have a voice and stick to that voice, but that not all of our audiences will mesh well with that exact voice. And the difference there is audience, the difference there is voice and tone, which is something that I'll get to soon. So that's one way that we measure our audiences and how that impacts our branding at Youth M.O.V.E. National. Then you really want to ask yourself, when you're determining who your audiences are, you want to ask, how do they like to receive information? So are the modes of communication you're using with those people closely aligning with the channels they use? You might think, for example, that social media is the best channel to reach youth, but you might find that in your community, actually, it's flyers in schools that is much more effective to reaching youth, or whatever the case may be. You would never know that if you didn't ask. So it's all about ensuring you're being culturally competent and most effective. So to go back to Hannah's question, how would we determine this at a Youth M.O.V.E. National scale? Well, we might say that maybe youth leaders mainly want to receive this information through email. So that's why we do weekly email. Maybe our partners want to receive this information through a bulletin or a newsletter. So we'll send them that information through a bulletin or a newsletter. Maybe it's in-person meetings, which would be really difficult because we all live in different parts of the country, but sometimes we do see each other face-to-face.
Michael, I think we lost your audio. I can't hear you still. Bear with us for a second, guys. So in the meantime, while we try to figure out Michael's technology situation, does anybody have any questions for Michael or I, or just any questions in general about the material that's been presented so far?
I'm back, by the way.
Oh, is that you, Michael?
Yes.
Right.
I was like cutting off in the beginning, and I should have said that that might have happened, and I have no idea why. The technology is a lot of fun. It keeps it interesting. So yeah, if anyone has any questions, please do leave in a chat box or just chime in through audio. I don't know where I left off, but what I was saying was one way we might determine how people might want to receive information, and I don't want to be basic about this, but it truly is just asking them. That's the way you determine most things about most plans, and it's true about communication planning as well. There's no harm in it. It's just whether that's through a survey or a focus group or a very indirect email or indirect way, you just want to ask, hey, what do you most pay attention to? And then sometimes, too, depending on what your channel is, you're going to have statistics. And Hannah could probably speak to this a little bit because she runs Youth National Social Media. For example, if your channel is a newsletter, you're probably using a program that has statistical information, and it's going to let you know whether people are actually opening it, whether they're actually clicking on that information. On Facebook, as Hannah probably talked to, there's information about how many people that post reached, whether or not they're engaging with it, whether or not they're liking it. That's true with Twitter as well. And so that's going to give you information, too, about whether or not that channel is being is effective, because then you're going to course correct. You're like, well, nobody is liking these Facebook posts, but I'm going to continue using it. That would be foolish. It's going to change your communication plan. So I hope that answers your question a little bit, Hannah, unless you have anything to add about Facebook stats.
No, I think that I wonder often about how to formalize the process of analyzing things or formalize the process of retrieving info from people about how they like to receive info. So I don't know for me, not being a social media person per se, I think I do a lot of informal information gathering and more observing. And I don't necessarily know what the more formal process looks like, or if that is a very worthwhile endeavor for a family org or a youth org that's starting up. So,
I think definitely sometimes you just have to lean into those instincts, especially because sometimes you don't have those resources. I wish Bree or Kristen were on this call right now, because we just went through a conversation at Youth National about how we're going to determine whether or not our communication is effective. We're developing that sort of survey. And it would be, of course, much better if all that data was formal. but sometimes it's not. So you do sometimes have to lean on those informal, like, is this what people like to use? And also, if you're a budding youth program, you're probably being folded into an organizational hierarchy that exists already. So people probably have their modes of communication. You can glean from it a little bit that way. So hopefully that's helpful. And then the last thing you want to ask yourself about your audience is, what kind of language do they use? You don't want to veer so far off that you begin to lose your voice, but you definitely want to know whether or not you should be using jargon or simple language or something else. There's a good saying that's like, the most important language is the one that communicates. And it's true here as well. If you're going on and on and on using acronyms, which systems of care love to use acronyms, there's acronyms everywhere, while communicating with a family member, as an example, even if it's in a brochure, and they have no idea what you're saying, you're not going to be effective, because that acronym or that term doesn't really mean anything to them. It's something you want to think about as well. At Youth Move National, as an example, the opposite can be true sometimes too, and it can be true in your case as well. Sometimes when you're speaking to someone who's a professional audience, you're going to leave that jargon in because it's shorthand for you and them, and they don't want to hear that sort of alternate terminology or alternate language that that makes sort of their job or their process of receiving that information slower or harder to gauge. So, yeah, those are the three questions that you want to ask yourself about your audience first, when you're first developing your communication plan. And then once you've done all that and you've figured out who your audiences are and asked yourself all those questions about all of your audiences, then it should be pretty easy to figure out the rest of your communication plan or model, right? You probably have a semblance of what it is you want to say, and now you know what it is that audience needs to know. So how can you leverage both of those things to be an effective communicator as an organization? You need to make it relevant to that audience, because otherwise what you're saying is not truly going to resonate with them. But you do want to hold some power as an organization as well. You don't want to, just because that's something they may want to know, that's not the same as something that they definitely need to know to further your organizational goals. So that's something to keep in mind. So that's the what to say piece, right? Once you know who your audience is and what it is they like to know and what it is that they like to know or need to know, rather, then you're kind of understanding what it is that you need to tell them. So whether that is meeting updates or whether that is bragging or whether that is information about your industry, now you know what it is that you need to know to tell them. And then once you figured out, sorry about that. And then once you figure that out, how they like to communicate, now you know I need to tell X audience information via newsletters. And I'm wondering if someone's unmuted because they want to ask a question or not. But maybe not. And then you figure out, I need to tell that audience this information via newsletter, and you tell that audience information via social media, and then I need to tell this audience information through in-person meetings, or whatever the case is. Of course, just like messages, you want to leverage that with the communications infrastructure that you already have. So then I promised a little bit about why those squiggly lines exist, and those squiggly lines represent the noise of a channel. So every channel has noise that you cannot change, and I don't mean literal noise, but sometimes I do, like during this webinar. So right now, for example, we're doing communications, right? My message is an overview of branding and communications. My channel is Direct Connect, this webinar, and my audience is all of you lovely people, but the noise associated with this channel are things that are beyond my control. I can't see your faces, so I don't know if you're interested or unbelievably bored out of your skull, which I hope is not the case, as an example, some people say that they hate email because they can't understand what the tone of the message was, which is understandable. So it's all that stuff that you can't really change. I say this because it's important to be cognizant of it. There is so much about communications that you can't change. You can't change your audience, as in who they are and what they value. You just can't. You can't always change your channel. Sometimes you're stuck with what you've got or what resources you can sustain. But you can always count on one thing. The fact that you can always change yourself and your message. You can always change your message. So be cognizant of that. And really, that's communication and the communication process or model or plan, whatever you want to call it. You want to know who your audiences are. You want to know what kind of messages you want to send to them. And then you need to know the channel you're going to communicate it through. And then all of that is filtered through your voice, because part of your brand is consistency. Like we were talking about before, the friend who loves Starbucks, like he loves it because anywhere in the country that he goes, or sometimes in the world, I was in London recently and it was a Starbucks and it was the same as it was in Miami or Seattle, except people had accents. Because that's really going to determine what people remember you by. The consistency is so key. So you really, really do want to filter all your messages through your voice. So that's really a communication model. Communications is when you're saying stuff to people. The model you do it through is what you're going to say, which are your messages, how you're going to say it, which is your channel, and who you're going to say it to, which is your audience. And then you want to filter all that through your voice to have this sort of consistent branding. I don't know if people have questions about that so far. I promise it's kind of, it's easy, right? I mean, not difficult. Okay. Yes, exactly. Eric, I wish you could expound on that a little bit more, that you spoke at a high school and had to tailor your message a little bit, because it was a different audience, most likely, than you were used to. And that happened. And I'll talk a little bit more toward the end of the presentation about what's the difference between trying to keep your voice while maintaining the integrity of your brand to different audiences who may not be receptive to that voice, which is something you're going to have to, it's a discussion you're going to have when you're branding and discussing your communications class. So I'm reading Eric's message. The class was for SED students and they were uncomfortable with new people, et cetera. Yeah, which happens often. Okay, so you know what branding is, or rather you know branding is more than how you look, and you know communication can help your brand, that they're linked inextricably. So how do we combine what we know about communication and our brand to strengthen what our brand is or what it stands for? So one of the most effective ways that we can strengthen or define our brand, as well as our voice and our personality, is by looking at a brand's six levels of meaning. This is going to help you come up with a personality and therefore a voice for your organization. There they are, the six of them. You can read them on the screen. We're going to try to go through them one by one, not ridiculously in depth, but we're going to try to go through them one by one. This is really going to, if you Google this after the presentation, it's really going to help you figure out what your organization's voice is, I think. So one of the first things you want to ask yourself when you're ready to define your brand's personality, you want to look at, what are your brand's attributes? It's that one thing you think of off the top of your head when you think of your brand. It's sort of like word associated, right? For example, Apple, it might be that you think of modern and clean cut. So try to do the same thing with organization. Yes, the slides will actually be available to download at the end of this presentation. With Apple, the attributes might be that it's innovative, that it's clean cut, that it's modern, depending on who you talk to. Some people might think that way, but definitely when you're thinking about your brand, it's like, what's the first thing you think of? Sort of like when I asked you before to think of someone you're close with. What's the first thing you think of that person? That's the same kind of question you want to ask about your brand. The second thing you want to ask yourself are, then what are the benefits? And you want to ensure that these benefits are tangible. They should not be abstract. Why should someone choose your brand over another brand? What are they going to get out of associating themselves with your brand? With the Apple example, the benefits might be that their products are, and sometimes this is kind of weird to answer, but you do have to put yourself in that space of like, why is anyone going to choose us? Like, there's so many, or there may not be, but sometimes there are other organizations sometimes doing the same work that you're doing, but what makes you stand out? And that's true for a lot of things, but it's definitely true for business, it's true for organizations, it's true for brands. You definitely need to stand out in some way. And truly, the way people, earlier I said that you can't really change your audiences, you can't, but what you can do is offer them benefits to sort of, compromise is not the word I want to say, but maybe leverage what they value and what they think to start choosing your brand. The third thing you want to think about is the values of your brand. I think this might be a little bit self-explanatory, but explore what your brand stands for, what causes does it value, what ideals does it hold itself to. As an example, again, with Apple, Apple's value might be that it has a commitment to innovation. Once again, depending who you ask, people who don't like the fact that they took off headphone jacks might hate that. I'm currently in a situation where I'm headphone jacked, but yeah, you want to know when people associate themselves with your brand, they really are associating themselves with an ideal or an ideology. What is the vision of your, or rather, what vision does your brand have of the future? Why is it that you're doing the work that you do? Then you want to think culture. Again, this might be pretty self-explanatory, but what's the culture of your brand? Is it youth-driven? Is it fun? Is it bold? Apple's culture might be that it's high quality and it's useful and it's modern. That's something that's true of your brand as well. What is the culture that it is portraying out to the world? Is it like this professional culture, buttoned up kind of thing? Or is it more loose, more fun, something in between? Figuring out your culture is imperative. I like to tell people that the culture is important because if you think about finding a new job as an example, it's one of the things you think about the most, like what kind of culture is it like here? Is it a place that fosters innovation? Or new ideas? Is it hands-off or is it hands-on? Is it a micromanaging culture? Is it a culture that agrees with my values or not? That's true of your brand as well. When people associate themselves with your brand, they're associating themselves with a type of culture that you uphold. And people want to be typically in cultures that that they agree with. Want to ask yourself, if your brand were a person, how would you describe that person? I've been doing this entire presentation, right? Brands are like people, not entirely, you know, but they kind of are. Remember, this is what people will remember your brand by. People don't remember other people by their hairstyles that often. The first thing they think about, like I said before, is are they funny? Are they a kind person? Are they warm? It's the same thing with your brand. If it's true in real life, it's true for your brand as well. Trust me. Trust me, trust me, trust me. It's one thing you'll be remembered by. I remember I was speaking about this recently, and what I brought up was, does anybody remember the Microsoft Zoom? It's so random. But that was probably 10 years ago, and that was about around the time that Microsoft was trying to reinvent its personality. So a lot of people thought of Microsoft and the personality they thought of was like professional, executives, buttoned up, and they were trying to change that to compete with the iPod and be like this fun, energetic, youthful brand it's 2016, and we still don't completely think about Microsoft that way. We still, when we think of Microsoft, we still kind of think of that executive kind of feel. We're not completely there yet with how they wanted to change their personality. And that's because their personality was in stone for decades, and it's what we remembered them by. If you look at around that time in 2006, they also changed their logo, but does anyone really know what their old or their new logo looked like and how it was different? You kind of really remember them by what their personality was. And I'm telling you, it's just so key to developing your brand. And lastly, what does your brand say about the person who's using it? This might seem a little like, I don't know, elementary school, but this could not be more imperative. People associate themselves with brands in large part because it says something about themselves. Someone who uses an Apple product might suggest to some people that they're early adopters and they're loyal. Even though that might be a positive thing to some of us, and that might be a negative thing to some of us, it's still an identity that people connect with. So really, you have to nail down what is it that your brand is going to be suggesting about the person who's associating themselves with it. Because people associate themselves with organizations, brands, whether it's Pose or whether it's your youth program, they associate with it, because, like I said, it says something about themselves. And so you've got it. You've asked yourself all these questions. You know what your voice is. In turn, you know what your brand is. You know who your audiences are and what they need to know and how to tell what they need to know to them. But you might be asking yourself, but if my voice and my brand is friendly, as an example, that's not going to do well with executives, right, or something. And true, that's a discussion that you need to have. But if we're comparing brands and voices to people, like I think I've been doing this entire presentation, the best way I can describe this to you is we're always ourselves. We always have the same voice and personality. Even if you don't really think that, it's true. As an example, I'm always me, like I say, but in different social situations, I'm different versions of myself. The way I talk to a friend, it's not the same way I talk to a boss or my mom or a stranger or someone I was meeting for the first time in a professional setting. It's a variation, but I don't completely lose myself. And that's called tone. When I do this in person, I like to ask people, have you ever gone to a party and then describe the events of that party to a close personal friend? Usually everyone raises their hand. And then I ask, is the way you describe that party to a close personal friend the same way you describe it to your mom? And everyone says no, that it's not. Because those are different audiences. So you're going to describe situations differently to those different audiences. It's the same in your communication and branding planning. We do this in everyday life. Do it in every single day life without even being aware that we're doing it. We switch our tone depending on who we're talking to. So if we're doing it in everyday life and we're not even thinking about the messages that we're actually communicating, why shouldn't it be true when we're actually strategically sending or communicating messages? It shouldn't be. It should be a part of your communication planning. So your voice is always the same, but your tone, that might change. So in the example earlier, your voice might be friendly, but with one audience, it might be friendly but professional. With another audience, it might be friendly but warm. With another, it might be friendly but silly or friendly but real. You shouldn't completely lose yourself when you're talking to a different audience. But it is a question you should leverage against your audiences. It is a question you need to ask yourself, and only I don't have the answers. I only have the questions. It really is something that you need to discuss within your group, whomever is coming up with your communications plan or your branding planning. Like, what's our voice? And then, okay, here are different audiences. How should we shift our voice and our messages just a bit to be much more effective communicators with those audiences? Okay. But there's just one last thing. You know branding is way more than design. You know what communications is, hopefully. You know how to develop a voice and a personality. What's left is being strategic about it in everything you do, but definitely in communication. You should have a goal. You want to have a path for determining whether or not you're being effective or successful. I provide technical assistance in social marketing to grantees nationwide, and I love all my grantees. There's one grantee who's so ambitious. They're so driven. They're doing so much. They do events for young people. They did an LGBTQI2S event. They did. They participate in health and wellness fairs. They did mental health trainings for law enforcement. They brought mental health into library systems because there are youth councils and their libraries, and they wanted to collaborate with those youth. It's all so great. And then you ask them the question, what, why, right? The big Sharpie, as my 11th grade teacher did, so what? Like, why did you do all that? And they can't come up with an answer because they didn't figure out before they started doing all their communications. They didn't figure out where it is that they want to be from point A to point B or point A to point Z or whatever the case is. They didn't know what it looked like. And when you're coming up with a communications goal, you need to hark back to what is it that your project goal is. Because communications doesn't exist in a vacuum. It's not just something you do for the sake of doing it. Communications is a way to support where it is that you want your organization to go or to be, or what causes you want to champion in your organization, and what the vision of the future your organization sees. I say that because I feel like we're all doing similar work, and we're doing a lot of advocacy work. So once you determine what your organization's goals are, then communications is there to support you in fulfilling those organizational goals. So what are some sample communications goals? What do they look like? Truly, it can be as simple as saying you want to provide information to stakeholders at a regular interval. That's a very noble goal. Trust me, you'd be way ahead of most people and organizations if one of your goals was just to streamline your communications and be very effective communicators. Another goal might be to become a thought leader in your community. When people think mental health or they think whatever else you specialize in your community, do you want them to think of you specifically? Do you want to shape what the conversations are that are happening around that subject? Do you want media coverage? Do you want to be a so-called expert? Right? It's a political season. You may have been watching cable news or any news. Those commentators on CNN who are always yelling at each other are thought of as the experts in political commentary. And in some way, shape, or form, they shape the conversation. So that might be a communication goal that you have, not about politics, but about mental health or different systems or what have you, whatever you're advocating for. That's a very noble and very ambitious ambitious goal, and I would recommend that. Or maybe it can be as simple as just an internal communications goal. Maybe you want to ensure that everyone is equipped with what they need to uphold your brand standard, which is great. Consider the path you want your organization to be on and equip people in your organization. This is something that is also happening inside National, is like, what is it that everyone needs to know so that we can consistently deliver that brand? Something we did recently is try to develop a content guide for how everyone would write as part of the Youth Move National brand, so that we're consistent everywhere we're writing, whether it's a Facebook post or whether it's a newsletter or it's a product document or resource. We want everyone that's, because we can't everything we write can't come from one person, right? That's almost impossible in the way that a lot of our organizations are set up. But we want everyone to be equipped with the tools and the knowledge that they need so that they can sound like they're all talking to each other, like everyone who's writing for Youth M.O.V.E is talking to each other, and that it's all strategic and there's a plan for it. Yeah. So figure out what your organization's goals are and allow communications to support you in that endeavor, because that's what it's there for.
Michael, so I just want to slow you down a little bit and give kind of an example of what a smaller, less grandiose communications like goal might be. And so before Johanna had help do in the member services department, she was sending out emails to the chapters, but her intention and her goal was for it to be weekly, but because she had such limited capacity as being just like one in the member services department, she wasn't necessarily able to meet that goal. But when Marika and I like tag teamed the member services department like we're doing now, that goal is something that kind of has become more than a, I mean, it's definitely still a goal, but it's like a more attainable goal that like we know that we can reach. And so we're able to like continue building on that. So now we're like, okay, so our goal is to send out one weekly communication, but also we have this goal of sending out chapter alerts for things that come up that are really important that we want our chapters to know about that might be, like, time-sensitive. So that's, like, a smaller snippet of, like, where you can maybe start your communications goals at, just making sure that, like, you post, like, let's say, like, I don't know, 5 times a week on Facebook. A communications goal, but it's obviously a lot less ambitious than the ones that you have up here.
Yeah, and I would say that you can really start as small, just to echo what you're saying, Hannah, as like, I want to ensure that I'm communicating at a regular interval. Because one of the things I see a lot when it comes to communications in different organizations, and it's not just organizations and this kind of work, it's communications is seen as sort of like a secondary thing that organizations don't think about. It's not something that they prioritize. When in fact, it's everything, every time you're talking to someone or developing a material that someone else is going to see, you're doing communications, but you're not being strategic or not being as effective as you could possibly be about it. So one example might be you were talking about weekly emails, but another might be that you have a newsletter that you want to send out, but you're right, you don't have the manpower, and that happens. You don't have the manpower to do it consistently, not consistently, but doing it at an interval that you ideally would want to do it at. So one of the goals you might set up is saying, okay, I can do this every week. Maybe you're so understaffed that you can't do it every month, but I can try to do this every other month. Because one of the things when it comes to a communication channel like a newsletter, if people begin to expect when it is that you're going to publish that next communication piece. Hannah probably talked to, when it comes to Facebook, it's the same. Like, she couldn't just go away for a week and it would be all fine. Scheduling is key when it comes to some of those communications channels. It sometimes is even key when it comes to meetings, right? When you set up meetings with, whether it's youth or you're setting meetings with people at the executive level, those meetings come at a regular interval. I've been part of, we're receiving new grantees. I was part of 2 new calls for grantee orientations this week. And the one question that consistently got asked in both those calls and will get consistently asked tomorrow when I have another call and next week is, can we have a meeting every month and schedule it now? Because people like that consistency. So really, if you're thinking of like what's a goal I can think of and hit and feel great about, finding that interval, that regular flow is key, I think. That would be a number one sort of like baby step goal, but also very, very noble goal to achieve, I think.
I have another question before we move on from sample goals or just goals in general. Like when you like, so when you're on calls and people are asking you about maybe creating a communications plan or just creating communications goals, not even necessarily a plan, do you have any tips for like who should be involved in that discussion? Whether it's like, you know, a family or a youth or like whatever, like are there multiple players that should be there and like making those choices and having a conversation? Like what does that look like?
Yeah. So I think in an ideal world, you want people who are part of your audiences to be part of your communication planning, especially in a system of care world, because those are part of our values. But even if you weren't, it's just smart planning. You don't plan without asking your audiences their opinion. So we talked a little bit earlier about getting that informal feedback from people, but it also might be a little more formal. It might even be a focus group. I've been part of focus groups for people, or actually, funnily enough, I've been part of test focus groups for people who are doing a survey and they want feedback on how those questions in that survey are posed. So that's a way of garnering that feedback. But when you're coming, so you might not be able to make an ideal group, and you might not ideally have a dedicated communications person, but I would say you definitely want to start with, depending on how you're set up, definitely want to start with the person who might have set up your program's goals, because whoever that person is going to have some say in or has knowledge of where you should be steering your communications goals. So that's key. The second is, if your youth program, why not youth leaders for starters, because they might be one of the audiences, but definitely because you want them to have buy-in into what your organization is doing. If you can get family members, that's one of your audiences, that's great too. But I think starting kind of within that realm is pretty good enough. Now, this is different from social marketing, which is a completely different beast, where ideally a social marketing work group would consist of all those different kinds of audiences. Communications, I would say, is a little bit different than that because it's much more consolidated. And also because there's so much about communications that you can figure out away from a group. You can get that informal feedback. But really, it's really about pushing what it is that you want to do as an organization and what it is that you want to communicate as an organization. When it comes to social marketing, and I'm bringing this up because sometimes people conflate the two, when it comes to social marketing, that's about changing people's behaviors in a positive way. And that's a much more invasive sort of practice that you definitely want people to use a slang term from the jump when you're planning that sort of social marketing piece. But in communications, I think you can get away with it streamlined. And also, I'm kind of an advocate for small groups because sometimes you get work done a lot faster when you have those streamlined groups. I hope that answers the question. Does anyone else have questions about that? Think about them as I talk about bringing it all together. Really, I hope by now you understand branding is way more than design. It's your voice, it's your personality, because that's what people are going to remember you by. Trust me, trust me, trust me. They're going to remember the colors and the font you use like we all did in the beginning of today, but it's not going to have an impact or some staying power if you don't connect what those colors and those fonts mean to a personality, to a value, to an ideal. That's going to ensure that your brand really does have some impact. I hope that you kind of think communication is pretty easy. I mean, once you know your audiences and you ask all those questions about your audiences, then you've kind of got it down pat. Because you know what the communication model is. It's just what you're saying, who you're saying it to, what you're saying, how you're saying it, and who you're saying it to. So once you figure out that piece of who you're saying it to, then the rest kind of just falls in place. You don't really have to think all that hard. And that's the part that I want to stress, because I truly do see people who just, like, forget about the communications piece. But it's so important because it's tied to everything you do. Everything you do in some way or another has to be communicated. Even things that you think might not be, I hate to use the term, but customer facing, at some point you might even have to report about it. And that becomes a communication piece that you have to put somewhere else. Which brings me to let your communication goals support your program goals. That's what they're there for. It's not church and state, right? They work together so seamlessly and so very well together. Once you know what it is or where it is that you want your program to be, communication just helps you get there. Whether it's spreading the good news, whether it's asking for fundraising dollars, or whether it's talking to legislators about policy, whatever the case is, communication is really there to help support your program goals. So let it. Don't get in its way. Align what you need to say to who needs to hear it. So I say this because, and that's really it. Like, once you write down all of your audiences, and then you write down all the things you need to communicate, and then it's just like drawing a line to what they need to know and who it is. And then that's really your communications plan. I promise it's that simple. And then, like, do it. Like, it's not that difficult. Once you've gone through these steps and you've figured out your communications plan, don't think of it as this daunting task or this process that you can't overcome. It's stuff you're already doing. You just need to get a little strategic about it, and I promise you'll be so effective. So truly, that kind of comes to the tail end of my presentation. I do want to open it up to questions if anyone has any. But if not, I believe we have the PowerPoint available to download. Somebody, I hope you guys can see it. If you do have questions, please continue typing. But if you want to learn more about communications, I do advocate these websites because they help, especially the samhsa.gov/children website, which has a lot of resources for communication and also social marketing, which we didn't touch upon, and branding, especially when it comes to organizations within system of care or systems of care. The second is, and I'm sure Hannah can attest to this, is canva.com. If you don't have a graphic design hand, Canva is like the easiest website to use to make some nice graphics. So if you're like, oh, I have all these messages that I want to get out, but no one's going to read them because my flyer kind of sucks, trust me, canva.com is like the epitome of what you want to use if you don't have that sort of knowledge. And then lastly, know how nonprofit.org is like a godsend when it comes to communication planning. It really lays it out really simply. This specific link that I have on here is an easy way to develop a communications plan. It lays it out to you like ABC 1, 2, 3. And I promise anyone who reads that article can come up with a communications plan without even having any knowledge previous to it. And then once again, So I see people are typing, so you might have questions. But if you think of a question after we hang up here today, and you're like, where does it go? This is my email, mcollado@youthmovenational.org. Always feel free to email me, and I will get back to you. And that's my presentation, unless people have questions.
So, Michael, as people are typing, I know that you just gave us a nice – oh, go ahead. You can go for that one.
Yeah. So just in terms of specific social media platforms, which do you think are the most useful, have the most potential to reach young people? From our participants, we hear mostly Facebook and Instagram. most adults seem to think Twitter for some reason. Okay, I joined Twitter right when it began, so I guess I have some sort of loyalty, but I just love the hashtagging and everything. But I don't, I have to agree, if I'm coming from an anecdotal space, I don't think it's very effective mean of reaching young people. I also don't think, Fritz, I think there's a misconception that social media is like the way to reach young people for the first time. And I don't necessarily agree with that. I think, as has been the case for decades, since the beginning of time, the best way to reach people is face-to-face. It's in person. The best way to do outreach, now I'm sort of saying something like unsolicited, but it really is by equipping peers with, informally, with information that they can share with their own peers, rather. Because word of mouth is so huge, and in person is so big. But social media can be very effective at maintaining that communication. So if I had to pick, I would probably go anything more visual. I feel like from all the things I'm reading and all the trends I'm seeing, like Instagram or Snapchat is more the way to go. And I think something that a lot of us overlook is actually Tumblr, which I think has a huge audience for the kind of work that we do and something that we're not really tapping into. Yeah. So I'm trying to scroll up because I missed a question by Eric. How do you communicate, or what are some good goals when talking with youth that have lived experience in something you're not personally familiar with? It's a great question, and I wish I had all the answers. I'm going to say that the number one thing you want to do is research. You definitely want to research those sort of topics that you don't want to know about. But I know this sounds simple and like a cop-out, but the number one thing really is always asking, you know, how should we be communicating about this subject matter? Because they're the experts of their own experience. So when it comes to communicating that specifically, truly you want to get tips from the person who's the expert in that subject matter. And yeah, I agree with Hannah, just being cognizant, being culturally and linguistically competent, and that harps back to researching. Ensuring that you don't have to be an expert, but you definitely want to look like you care enough to look into it a little bit. That's it.
So, Michael, I have one last question I'm going to bug you with. For people that are joining us today that have none of this, like, in place, and maybe they just have a brand because that's what their organization felt like they needed to do, like, right off the bat, what would you say, like, the next step is? Like, if you can break it down to be a little bit, like, less overwhelming if there are people here that are, like, just starting. I know that when I was just starting, hearing a presentation like this has been, like, oh, my gosh, mind-blowing. Like, there's so much good information, but it's just me. Like, where do I start here? Like, what would you say, like, your most important next steps, like, simply might be?
Okay, the first thing I would say is to reassure you that it's not a lot. Trust me. The second I would say is to understand what your resources are, because you don't want to overstep. You can't do everything, especially like you said, Hannah, if it really is just you, you can't do everything. You're going to have to prioritize. What's the most important thing that you want to communicate? So those are the two things that I would keep in someone's mind. If I were to think of next steps, I would start with what are your program goals? What is it that you want to accomplish? And then how is it that I'm going to get there by the things that I'm communicating? So really, if you're a new person and you're not a new person, but you're a person new to like communications work and you're like, it's just me, what do I do? Go back to what your goals are as an organization and say, okay, this is where I need to be. Here are the things I need to communicate to get there. And that's really step one, I would say.
Awesome, thank you. So as Michael said, he is available to answer any questions that you might have while you're, you know, taking into account all this great information. And we hope that this was helpful information for all of you, and continue asking questions in the chat box if you have any, but it seems like no one's typing, and I want to be mindful of everybody's time. So I think we'll give it like another minute if anybody starts typing, and if not, thank you so much for being our content expert today, Michael. I think that everybody got a lot out of it, and I hope that you guys join us for our next Direct Connect, so be on the lookout for details about that coming up. Thanks, everyone. Have a good night.